And now we turn to the analysis of Brooks and Capehart, that is New York Times columnist David Brooks and Jonathan Capehart, columnist for The Washington Post. So good to see both of you on this Friday night. It's the first time we've seen you since the impeachment trial last week ended last Saturday, President Trump. Jonathan, it seems almost every day this past week, though, we've been hearing from different Republican state officials about how they were going to punish or censure Republican senators who voted to convict, whether it was Senator Cassidy in Louisiana, Senator Toomey in Pennsylvania. There's talk that he will be censured. How deep is the animosity toward these lawmakers who voted against former President Trump?
I think the animosity is deep, very deep. I mean, these state party chairs, one might be responding in their own capacity, these state parties in their own capacity, but they are a reflection of the Republican Party base. You know, Judy, when I interviewed former RNC chairman Michael Steele back in August of 2016, and I talked to him about the candidacy then of Donald Trump running for president, being the nominee. And he told me then that he thought that the nomination of Donald Trump would hasten the conversation that the Republican Party needed to have about who they are, what they value, and certainly about the role of race within the party. Fast forward, Donald Trump becomes president, Donald Trump loses an election, but in the process, Donald Trump has transformed the Republican Party into one that is completely loyal to him. And so people who voted for his impeachment, people who voted for him, voted guilty, wanted him to be convicted in the last go round with this impeachment trial, those are the folks who are riling up this super loyal base within the Republican Party that is loyal to Donald Trump. And I think what we're going to see down the road is whether these censure votes, whether these reprimands of these right. Republicans, who I think voted their conscience, whether those actually have any political power, meaning bumping them from office in that way.
David, how do you see this animosity, division inside the Republican Party?
Well, Trump is popular, and when Democrats and the media seem to be attacking Donald Trump, the Republicans sure rally around. 78% of Republicans say right now they want Donald Trump to play an important role in the future of the party. Underneath that, there are divisions, and they show up between the normal Republicans and the Trump Republicans. And you can ask, who do you feel more loyal to, the party or Donald Trump? And there it's about 50-50. And then there's an important split when you ask Republicans, should we work with Democrats? And there again, you see the regular Republicans versus the Trump Republicans. The regular Republicans, who seem to be a slight majority, want to work with Democrats. The Trump Republicans do not. I think the party leaders have decided we can't have this fight over Donald Trump. We have to displace Trump with policymaking. And so today, this week, Tom Cotton and Mitt Romney began to work together to create a bill that would raise the minimum wage and fix enforcement of immigration on the border. And they're trying to make the party a regular party, so it's not just a media party, but a party that actually does legislation. I think that's a pretty promising way to try to displace Trumpism.
But meantime, Jonathan, you had former President Trump coming out this week, appearing on three different, I guess, conservative TV channels, still talking about how the election was stolen, attacking Mitch McConnell. Is McConnell hurt by this? I mean, I guess I'm asking how lasting is this damage the former president still trying to level?
Look, in a battle between Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell and Donald Trump, I put my money on Mitch McConnell. Senator McConnell is, you know, worried about two things, one of which he has succeeded. Judges was the first one, but the most important thing is power. He lost the Senate majority, primarily because of what then President Trump did that allowed those two Georgia seats to flip to the two Democrats, Warnock and Ossoff. But also, you know, Senator McConnell wants that majority back. And so that's why I think we saw him, on the one hand, vote for the acquittal of Donald Trump, but then after that vote, excoriate Donald Trump, lay the blame right at his feet. And in doing that, what I think Mitch McConnell is doing is creating an environment for his caucus and those Republicans running for the Senate in 2022 and 2024, giving them the room to be able to run races that would give them the best chance at winning. And when it comes to Donald Trump, you know, it's all about him. It's not about the party. It's not about policy, as David was talking about. It's about him and loyalty to him. And so if you're Mitch McConnell and you are about power, but you're also about doing things that advance the Republican Party, you're going to do whatever it takes to push Trump to the side and make it possible for those candidates to come to the fore.
So, David, who's got more muscle, Mitch McConnell or Donald Trump? And I do want to ask you both about Rush Limbaugh, but McConnell first.
Yeah, I questioned McConnell's strategy last Saturday, doing that acquittal vote and then excoriating, as Jonathan said. You know, Napoleon said, if you're going to take Vienna, take Vienna. But maybe Jonathan writes, it sets the Republicans up for a good run in 2022. And let's face it, you'd have to think it's likely the Republicans will take the House and Senate. That's just the way, what happens in midterm elections. The opposition party does very well. And I think McConnell's main goal is to keep really extreme Trumpians from getting Republican nominations in these Senate races and House races. And so maybe he's playing that game, just trying to ride this thing out and not try to fire everybody up and fire up the Trumpian base.
And David, in just a few words, the legacy of Rush Limbaugh.
Well, he changed media. He changed AM radio. Before Rush Limbaugh, hosts tend to be not too opinionated. After Rush Limbaugh, on left and right, hosts are super opinionated. He changed conservatism from George F. William F. Buckley to what we have today. So he had a big positive effect on media, I think, and a pretty negative effect on American conservatism.
Jonathan, it was on the media, as David says. It was also on the Republican Party and on conservatism broadly.
Right. My relationship when it comes to Rush Limbaugh is more than complicated, as someone who was attacked by him many times when he was on the radio. I mourn for his I mourn for his family and the people who loved him. But I quite honestly do not, simply because of the corrosive nature of his radio programming and what he did with the power that he had, you know, the corrosive nature that he had on American politics, on American political discourse. And if, you know, legacies can be good and legacies can be bad. And I think for me personally, Rush Limbaugh's legacy is one that has harmed the country.
All right. President Biden, first month in office after tomorrow. David, what are you seeing so far? And before you answer that, let me ask you both to respond to something President Biden said at this CNN town hall on Wednesday night, reminding us that he's not comfortable yet in this new job. Let's listen.
I was raised in a way that you didn't look for anybody to wait on you. And it's where I find myself extremely self-conscious. They're wonderful people work at the White House. But someone, you know, standing there and, you know, making sure hands me my suit coat.
So, David, I guess I should have said not comfortable with the trappings of the office yet.
Yeah, I mean, it's so weird being president. Every president talks about this. You're never alone. Secret Service knows when you go to the bathroom. They know when you're in the elevator. George W. Bush would ride his his mountain bike, up at a training center, a Secret Service training center in Maryland, and he would try to ride in front of the agents because he said that was the only time of his week when there weren't people in front of him and he could look out and sort of be alone. And so it's just very weird being president, I think very hard. As for President Biden, I think he's doing a lot of sensible things on his own. What's different from the Obama start, and Obama had a bigger Senate majority, Obama passed some big legislation right away. Lilly Ledbetter week one, children's health care week two, the stimulus package week three. So there was a lot of legislative action. There hasn't been as much from President Biden.
Jonathan, how do you see these first 30 days?
Well, I see them as terrific. if only because we have a president of the United States who's focused on governing, who's focused on doing things on behalf of the American people, but who is also not focused on being in our faces 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, with all manner of vitriol and nastiness towards his political opponents or even regular citizens. Judy, what I love about that clip you showed of President Biden talking about his not being comfortable with the trappings of the presidency is that's the man the American people voted for. It's a person who, for whom service, public service, the emphasis is on the service, but it's also the public, someone other than himself. You know, he is that boy from Scranton whose family had hard times and he worked his way up to the highest office in the land. And the idea that, you know, with this office comes someone who hands him his suit coat in the morning, or to David's point, you know, he and his family now are never alone. That I think it resonates with the American people because this is someone for whom power is something that's part of the job. It wasn't anything that he strove for just for power's sake. For him, being president of the United States is about helping people.
And David, less than a minute, but your thoughts on whether he's getting people behind him? I mean, is it your sense that he's building the kind of public support he's going to need?
Yeah, I think he is, actually. He's amazingly done very well at holding the Democratic Party together, which was not natural. I think he's done that extremely skillfully. His approval rating, there really have been not so many errors. One little error about when schools are going to reopen, but pretty much else, it's a professional organization, just as it was a professional campaign.
All right. It's only been a month. We'll do this every month, every week. We'll keep asking. How's he doing? Very good to see both of you. Have a good weekend.
You,
David Brooks, Jonathan Capehart. Thank you both.